Link TV, connecting you to the world. Link TV is viewer supported. Watch more at linktv.org.
Link TV presents Mosaic World News from the Middle East. Here are today's top stories.
Can Maliki win with a Baghdad recount? U.S. complains to Syria of arms sales to Hezbollah. And flights resume in Europe, but travel chaos is not over. Mosaic World News from the Middle East begins now.
على صعيد آخر توقع المالكي أن تسفر إعادة
Iraqi Prime Minister Maliki expects the manual recount of votes in the capital Baghdad, which was approved by the Independent Electoral Committee to produce different election results. The State of Law coalition led by Maliki came in second after the Iraqiya coalition, which is led by Iyad Alawi.
The appeal submitted by incumbent Iraqi Prime Minister Nouri al-Maliki was partially accepted, and an electoral body ordered the recount of votes in Baghdad.
In terms of how possible it is, I expect the vote recount in Baghdad to produce different results.
The significance of this measure lies in that the capital has 68 seats in the parliament, out of a total of 325 seats. The State of Law coalition led by Maliki gained 26 seats, while Al-Iraqiya led by Iyad Alawi gained 24.
The judicial court's decision on the manual vote recount is a pitiful one. We believe this manual recount is just a response to the request submitted by the head of the State of Law coalition.
Iraqi Vice President Tariq al-Hashimi required that all the political blocs comply with the decision, calling for the guarantee of its success.
We have to guarantee that the team to supervise the recount is appointed by an independent institution such as the United Nations, and that the team is highly competent.
But many believe that the ongoing conflicts between the two coalitions will not solve the crisis in the formation of the government. It will need both sides to guarantee an alliance that can form the majority in the parliament, which was not gained by any bloc in the March 7th election.
When we talk about the national acceptability of the prime minister, we are not talking about a prime minister for his party or coalition, but a prime minister for all of Iraq. He must be accepted by all Iraqis. In order to get elected, he needs their votes in the parliament. Under these circumstances, we can see that Mr. Maliki and Mr. Alawi are facing some difficulties. Some national communities have already formed their opinions on these two individuals and their blocs.
According to Hamdiya Hassani, the head of the election department of the Independent Electoral Commission, the manual recount will begin immediately. According to Maliki's coalition, the decision came after electoral fraud was confirmed and included changing signatures, wiping off, and changing some of the numbers. The decision is expected to cause more delay in the negotiations between the blocs in their quest to form the future government. In turn, this will fuel further disputes between the State of Law and the Iraqiya coalitions. Firas Kalani, BBC. Syrian Foreign Ministry spokeswoman Bushra Kanafani said that she was surprised when Washington repeated its allegations that Syria provided Hezbollah with Scud missiles.
In response to Washington's decision to summon a Syrian diplomat, Kanafani told Al Jazeera over the phone that Syria had warned the U.S. about the Israeli motives behind these allegations. She added that the U.S. allegations are based on Israeli claims, which may deepen the gap between the U.S. and Syria.
إلى الخارجية الأمريكية استدعي أرفع دبلوماسي سوري في واشنطن ليسمع ما اعتبرته دمشق.
The most senior Syrian diplomat in Washington was summoned to listen to allegations that Damascus provided Hezbollah with long-range Scud missiles. The U.S. sees the potential transfer of weapons to Hezbollah as provocative behavior, but Syria believes that the accusations are aimed at paving the way for a future Israeli war in the region. The U.S. State Department released a statement saying that the potential transfer of weapons to Hezbollah may pose an immediate threat to Israel's security, Lebanon's sovereignty, and stability in the region. What is worth mentioning is that the accusations were not substantiated in the statement. The Syrian diplomat was summoned as Congress was about to discuss sending a new U.S. ambassador to Syria. This has led some to believe that the pro-Israel lobby is using these allegations as a way to stop the improvement of the relations between the U.S. and Syria. Political analysts say that Israel has always increased its anti-Syria campaigns whenever the relationship between Damascus and Washington was about to improve. They believe that the Syrian diplomat was summoned after the Israeli president accused Damascus of providing Hezbollah with Scud missiles. Israel made these allegations just as the U.S. Congress was about to discuss sending an American ambassador to Damascus. Obama's appointment of an ambassador to Syria in February 2009 also coincided with Israeli threats to hit Syria and, quote, return it to the Stone Age.
تصاعد التهديدات الإسرائيلية بضرب سوريا بل وإعادتها أيضا إلى القرون الوسطى.
Military experts question the reason for which Hezbollah would want to have Scud missiles, seeing that they are very large in size. They say that Hezbollah needs much smaller missiles that can be quickly maneuvered.
وليس لما يجعله يتحرك كثيرا. فصحيح أن مدى صاروخ سكود نحو 700 كيلومتر.
The Scud missile has a 700-kilometer range, which means that it can reach any target in Israel, including the Dimona nuclear reactor. But the missile needs 45 minutes to be launched, which makes it an easy target and easily destroyed. Military experts also raise the question of why Hezbollah would use Scud missiles, since it has the Iranian Fatah missiles, which have the same range as a Scud missile, but only half the weight.
أقل عن صواريخ سكود مع ميزة تحسب لصالحه وهي أن زنته تبلغ نصف زنة سكود.
These questions compel the Lebanese foreign minister to compare allegations against Hezbollah of having Scud missiles to allegations against Iraq of having weapons of mass destruction, which turned out to be untrue. Iraqi weapons of mass destruction only existed in the imagination of the Bush administration and the neoconservatives.
بوش المنصرفة ومنظرها من المحافظين الجدد.
Hanan El Rome, and this is IBA News coming to you from Jerusalem. The nation remembers its fallen today, Remembrance Day, for 22,682 soldiers who died in defense of Israel and 3,971 civilians murdered in terrorist attacks. IBA's Eli Wagalanta reports.
Sirens rung out at 11 o'clock this morning while pedestrians stood at attention and traffic came to a standstill as motorists stepped out of their cars and bowed their heads. The main ceremony marking the somber day was held this morning at the Mount Herzl Cemetery in Jerusalem in the presence of President Shimon Peres, Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, IDF Chief of Staff Gabi Ashkenazi, and other dignitaries and government officials. On this day, the entire nation embraces all mothers and all fathers, brothers and sisters, sons and daughters and wives who have lost loved ones, Netanyahu said. Our loss is too heavy to bear. Our consolation is to continue the path of our loved ones and fulfill their dreams. Netanyahu spoke of his days as a soldier in the elite Sayeret Matkal unit when his friend died in his arms, and also of his mother's difficulty bearing the loss of his brother Yoni. The Prime Minister also delivered a political message. We are a nation that seeks peace and prays for peace. Our one hand is extended in peace to all our neighbors who seek peace, and our other hand holds on to the sword of David in order to defend our people against those seeking to harm us, said Netanyahu. Defense Minister Ehud Barak spoke at the Kiryat Shaul Military Cemetery in northern Tel Aviv. We stand here in front of this long row of headstones, which are the tangible witnesses to the price you paid in blood, dear families, for our nation to live in its land, Barak began. A state is not given to the nation on a silver platter, and freedom is only given to those who are willing to defend it. Throughout the day, radio stations played somber music and devoted programs to retelling the stories of soldiers killed in battle, and places of entertainment such as movie houses and restaurants were closed. Ceremonies were also held throughout the country at schools, IDF bases, and at each of the nation's 43 military cemeteries. Other ceremonies took place for various communities whose sons and daughters paid the highest price in service of the state, including for Druze and Bedouin soldiers. The Prime Minister, President, and Knesset Speaker Reuven Rivlin also attended the ceremony this afternoon in memory of terror attack victims. Memorial Day ends at 8 o'clock tonight, when Independence Day celebrations begin. Eli Wogelanter, IBA News.
Remembrance Day began last night with the traditional ceremony at the Western Wall in Jerusalem. President Shimon Peres opened the state ceremony, addressing the bereaved families gathered there, telling them, "For you, Remembrance Day does not start with the siren or end with the lighting of the Independence Day torches." And he added, "Your sacrifice was not in vain." The president's message was a somber one. He referred to Iran and others who are challenging Israel's survival and threatening to annihilate the Jewish state, warning that we must not make light of those threats. But he stressed, neither should our enemies make light of Israel's capacity to defend itself. He said Israel does not seek war. We are a nation that yearns for peace and knows how to defend itself. Chief of Staff Lieutenant General Gabi Ashkenazi saluted his fallen comrades and cautioned the existence of the State of Israel cannot be taken for granted. We must continue to guard it from enemies, even as we strive to establish a just, growing, and democratic society, a society that sanctifies the values for which the sons and daughters went on their final missions. Dozens of ultra-Orthodox Jews in the Mea Shearim neighborhood of Jerusalem marred Memorial Day by throwing stones at passing cars, burning trash cans, and desecrating Israeli flags. The disturbances took place on the main thoroughfares of Shiftei Israel Street and Shabbat Square. Police arrived at the scene and arrested a 14-year-old who had burned an Israeli flag soon after the memorial siren. Municipal workers extinguished the fires in the trash bins and order was quickly restored.
Today, Palestinians are commemorating Land Day. Despite the complete closure of the West Bank until tomorrow morning, a traditional march was organized in the village of Meska. The Association for the Defense of Palestinians, who were forcefully displaced in 1948, reiterated its rejection of plans to settle Palestinians away from their homeland or their compensation. Instead, they insist on the Palestinians' right of return. The association also called on Arab Israelis to participate in the demonstrations, which are being held as Israel celebrates its independence. Our reporter Ziad Halabi joins us from the village of Meska in the Arab Triangle inside Israel. Do you have any information about the march that will take place in Meska?
In less than 2 hours, the march will start from the village of Meska, whose population was displaced in 1948. The population of the village was displaced again in 1953 by Israel. In 2006, the school of the village was destroyed to prevent Palestinians from going back there. Arab Israelis have been holding this demonstration every year for the past 13 years. They insist on commemorating this unofficial Land Day, which they call the Nakba, or catastrophe in Arabic, despite Israel's opposition, which considers this day to be their Independence Day. Joining me is an eyewitness who saw the events that took place in the village during the time. Haj Musa Shbet left the village when he was 23 years old. Let me ask you, what happened here in 1948?
You're asking me what happened? All the populations of all the villages in this area were forcefully displaced.
Where did you go?
Not all of us went to Tire. Some of us went to Qalqilya and some went to the West Bank. Regardless of where they were, everyone stayed with their relatives.
You live very close to the village.
I only live a kilometer and a half away from it.
Do you participate in these demonstrations all the time?
Yes, and sometimes we just come and sit in the village.
Why?
We just can't let go of it. We're very old, but we still can't let go of it.
Do you still remember what was in the village?
Of course, I was 23 years old. I was not a child. I was very aware of what was going on.
Was there resistance to prevent the takeover of the village?
As you know, at the time we heard about the Deir Yassin incident, which took place only a few days before the village was taken. Also, we received threats, so it was normal for us to leave the village. If we did not leave, we would have probably had the same fate as the Deir Yassin residents. They forced us to leave. We did not know what would happen to us if we were to stay.
For thousands of travelers stranded at the airport, cross-border trains are still the only way out. They are waiting for French air traffic to fully recover from the volcanic ash so that this constrained wait can come to an end. The crisis has activated the taxicab market in an unprecedented way. Mohamed Wamusi reports from Paris.
Abdullah is a police officer in Dubai. He flew to Paris from the Emirates with his wife. He was expecting to transfer in the French capital and then head to Belgium to participate in a training session. Abdullah is in the same situation as thousands of other travelers. Struck by a flight crisis caused by the Iceland volcano eruption, Abdullah is stuck in Paris.
This is a crisis and we must deal with it. God willing, we will find alternative means of transportation. God willing, we will go south to Geneva, Germany, and Vienna. We contacted the UAE embassy and God willing, if there is anything that can be done, they will help us.
Abdullah's happiness was indescribable after he received a train ticket from Paris to Brussels. Abdullah's problem was solved, but for many other travelers, their problems still loom. Europe's paralyzed air traffic forced tens of thousands of travelers to use the Eurostar train. The management of the train added an additional 80,000 seats to cope with the increased number of travelers, but the crisis is still at its peak.
Usually when I take the train, there are not that many passengers. This time, however, all the trains are crowded.
I'm stuck here. If I had known this would happen, I wouldn't have traveled. I'm stuck here with my baby, and it's very difficult.
However, car rental companies are doing well during this crisis. Most of them rented all of their vehicles, and they no longer have any to rent. These are members of the famous Italian band Egiziano. They were invited by French television to participate in an artistic program. As soon as the program ended, the suffering of these men started.
The airport was also closed today. We desperately need a car. I have no other means of transportation to go back home.
Some experts say that the intensity of the volcano will increase in the coming few days, and they hope that the wind will push the ash and gas away. It stopped raining in Europe, but it seems that the wind is not going in the direction hoped for by the airlines. Mohamed Wamusi, Dubai Television, Paris.
Paris.
The Pakistani army held a massive military drill near its border with India. Leaders of the army said that the drill aims to exercise deterrence strategies against systematic attacks. It is worth mentioning that India and Pakistan have engaged in three wars since their separation in the middle of the last century.
These are the largest maneuvers to be held by the Pakistani army in more than 20 years. The desert region of Khorasan near the Indian border was chosen for the drill, which seems to send a vague message. In half a century, the two countries had three wars, and three-quarters of the Pakistani military forces are still deployed by the border of the disputed region in Kashmir. The event sent a lot of other messages. One of them may be the timing of this drill, which comes only days after a constitutional amendment expanded the authority of the prime minister, who attended the drill in the absence of the president. The prime minister had a different opinion.
The world today sees Pakistan as standing in grievance facing extremist forces and armed groups, despite the fast development of our economy and prosperity.
وإلى هنا رمى رئيس الوزراء بكلمة.
From here, the Pakistani Prime Minister gave a speech to the western side of the country, close to the border with Afghanistan. The Pakistani army has been engaging in a war in Afghanistan against the Pakistani Taliban for 1.5 years. The U.S. wants the Pakistani army to focus on this war, while the Pakistani people think that their country's top threat lies in the east, or more specifically, their strong neighbor India. The Pakistanis want their army to head east as long as the tension there continues for a variety of reasons, most prominent of which is the dispute over Kashmir. The message of the Khalistan drill seems to be that the Pakistani army is working for the Pakistani agenda. Asadullah Sawi, BBC.
A number of Bahraini activists have called on Saudi King Abdullah bin Abdulaziz to end his country's meddling in what they describe as a criminal act of sectarian naturalization in Bahrain. The group, which includes Sunni and Shiite political and social blocs, sent the Saudi king a letter during his last visit to Bahrain. In the letter, the group urged the king to mount pressure on Manama to stop its naturalization campaign. The group also pleaded to the Saudi king to prevent Saudi tribes from collaborating and taking part in the process, which aims to influence the country's general elections and change its demographic makeup. The group also called for the immediate repeal of all Bahraini citizenships granted in that process. The letter warned of the danger of meddling in Bahraini affairs, especially after several Saudi nationals who have been naturalized in Bahrain were implicated in a number of terrorist attacks launched inside and outside the kingdom. Joining us from Manama is Dr. Abdeljalil Al-Singas, the head of the Human Rights Council of the Bahrain Haq Movement. Dr. Al-Singas, do you expect the Saudi king to meet the list of demands enclosed with your letter?
يعني احنا نتمنى ان تكون الرساله وصلت الى العاهل السعودي لما نعتقد.
We hope that the letter was received by the Saudi monarch. This issue is not related to the Bahraini people and the state of Bahrain per se. It poses a threat to the security and stability of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, and this will negatively reflect on the stability of the entire region.
The issue of dual citizenship,
which includes the improper usage of Bahraini citizenship, has cast its shadow over the Saudi kingdom. Bahrain is also concerned by this issue, but aside from minor arrests in various parts of the country, it has not led to any major security breaches. The objective behind the naturalization of foreigners in Bahrain is to forge the country's general elections, as well as change its demographics. Having said that, we have reservations about the overall election process. The role of the newly naturalized is to undermine the willpower of the Bahraini people, as well as marginalize the indigenous people who, for a long time, played a vital role in the political process. This political polarization in Bahrain will negatively reflect on the country's stability. The situation in Bahrain is directly linked to the situation in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, as well as the region as a whole. Consequently, it's very important to deal with the issue in a serious and practical way, as it may reflect on the stability of Bahrain as well as the entire region.
In another development, Saudi Interior Minister Naif Abdulaziz refused to reopen the mosques that were closed in the area of Sharqiya due to undisclosed security and sectarian reasons. According to the Haramain website, a delegation of religious clerics and representatives of the Ismaili sect met the Saudi prince in his office, where he informed them that the closure of the mosques was final. Bin Abdulaziz further said that the closure of the Ismaili mosques is linked to security and sectarian matters in reference to the Shiite sect of Kubr. Over the past few months, Saudi Arabia has closed 9 mosques for the followers of the Prophet's family. Meanwhile, UN Human Rights Commissioner in Saudi Arabia, Navi Pillay, called on Arab states in the Persian Gulf to lift all the obstacles that are hampering women's full participation in public life. Pillay said that women in the region are still unable to fully enjoy their human rights, adding that discriminatory barriers continue to hamper women's rights to shape their own lives and choices, as well as be part of public debates.
Drug usage is not a new phenomenon, but what's new is that it has started to reach youngsters still in school. Rania Sanjar has the report.
All kinds of narcotic grass grow here, from marijuana to heroin. Their usage is no longer limited to a certain age group or a particular social stratum. According to social observers, these drugs have become popular among school children.
He lives in this neighborhood. I was going up to the roof and I saw him on the floor with syringes next to him.
How old is he?
He's 22 or 23. After that, he started stealing from his parents and even threatened them with weapons.
When 17 is the average age of a drug addict, that implies that they started using drugs at the age of 13. At the age of 13, they are still in school. For example, in one case, a student gave his friends a joint, they went and smoked it. When the principal found out, it turned out that it was his father who gave it to him and told him that it was very good. In other cases, you find drugs sold on the street inside food items.
According to the General Bureau of the Internal Security Forces, in 2009, 79 drug consumers were under the age of 18. 1,002 were between 18 and 25 years old. 791 were between 26 and 35 years old. And 356 were 36 and above. As for the gender of drug consumers, 2,122 were male and 106 were female.
If we compare the number of student drug users to the total number of drug users in Lebanon, we see a low percentage. Only 6% of all drug users are students. But naturally, as the head of the Drug Fighting Bureau, when we hear alarm bells, we urge sufficient measures to be taken to reduce the amount of drug usage to its lowest possible number.
According to statistics released by the General Bureau of the Internal Security Forces, the number of drug users under the age of 18 dwindled in 2006 in comparison to last year. This trend continued in 2007 and 2008, but in 2009, the number suddenly increased. There is no doubt that this increase is a clear sign of the outbreak of this vice among the youth and the existence of a serious problem that must be solved.
The views expressed on Mosaic are from contributing broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible from support of viewers like you. Thank you. Watch Mosaic World News online, stay up to date with breaking news, read our blog, get transcripts of past shows and more at linktv.org/mosaic.
This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.